I'm Philip Anderson, and I'm with Veterans for Peace. And we're, like I mentioned earlier, going to be honoring the 71st anniversary of the bombing of Nagasaki and also Hiroshima. Hiroshima was on August 6th, Nagasaki on August 9th. And we're going to be remembering those tragic events and also calling for action to eliminate and abolish nuclear weapons. We're being sponsored today by Veterans for Peace, Grandmothers for Peace, the Hildegard House Catholic Workers, UCD Peace and Justice Committee, and Nuke Watch. And we're going to be starting off with some music.
No, with John LaForge.
Oh, John? Okay. John LaForge from Nuke Watch is going to come and talk with us to begin with.
Thank you, Phil. I was leisurely holding the banner. I thought I was going to be much later.
You're our lead.
Yeah, thanks for coming out today, people. In this hot summer, I'm reminded of a summer I spent in Washburn, Wisconsin, in the Bayfield County Jail, 1995. And it was a crowded old place, and there was a bit of graffiti scratched over one of the toilets, kind of right into the block, so it was permanent. If anybody plays poker, you're gonna know this is a good joke. It said, a flush beats a full house in this place every day. And I think the principle applies to the nuclear weapons program that the Obama administration proposed in 2010 and which is moving forward through Congress. With climate change, mass incarceration, water shortages, global refugee migration, infrastructure decay, reactor disasters, and police murders, and a dozen other crises in need of broad and immediate attention. The U.S. must cancel plans for spending $1 trillion over 30 years on rebuilding the nuclear weapons complex.
Yes.
The plan, as it stands, is to spend $4 million, excuse me, every hour until 2046. $4 million an hour. About $330 billion is set to be wasted every 10 years for three decades to replace nuclear warheads, missiles, submarines, long-range bombers, and the land-based ICBMs, intercontinental ballistic missiles. The U.S. military budget, and the nuclear weapons complex in particular, steals resources from these urgently needed efforts to promote the general welfare. We all know this. It transfers enormous amounts of wealth from taxpayers to a tiny cabal of giant war profiteers, including Lockheed Martin, Northrop Grumman, Boeing, General Dynamics, Raytheon, and many others. Nuclear weapons contractors in the United States brought in $334 billion in government contracts between 2012 and 2014. As the philosopher said 30 years ago, this nuclear weapon system kills without being used by forcing people to starve. The U.S. must cancel plans for example, a new nuclear warhead and a new missile known as the Long Range Standoff Warhead, LRSO. The savings from cancellation of just this one program would be $30 billion, according to the Alliance for Nuclear Accountability. The Congress must cancel plans for 1,000 new long-range cruise missiles, which are set to replace current air-launched cruise missiles. In a letter to Mr. Obama last month, 10 Democratic senators called for this cruise missile, called the missile an unnecessary capability that could increase the risk of nuclear war. end quote. The military experts, several of them, have called for the cancellation of this program, including former Defense Secretary William Perry, who's also gone on to suggest the permanent elimination of land-based ICBMs, a subject with which I'm quite familiar. NUQUATS just last November published Nuclear Heartland, a revised edition, and a look at the remaining 450 land-based missiles that are still set on hair trigger alert in the Great Plains, that have been the source of so many scandals, drug scandals, cheating scandals, proficiency exam scandals, and these most recent crises that have struck the missile crews has resulted in the call by many high-level military officials for the elimination of these Cold War relics. In the spring of 2015, Obama met at Camp David with the dictatorial and chauvinist monarchies of the Persian Gulf, Bahrain, Kuwait, Oman, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, and the UAE. This is just another example of grotesque weapons largesse. At Camp David, they agreed to massive increases in weapon sales to the region, as well as the construction of a regional missile defense, so-called. U.S. aerospace corporations, of course, will make billions from this deal if it is funded, explained as a reaction to Iran's so-called nuclear weapons program. It is a colossal scam, a boondoggle, and amounts to embezzlement, I suggest, because Iran's nuclear program was halted many years ago, as the CIA and the International Atomic Energy Agency have attested. Another production complex, the Y-12 plant in Oak Ridge, Tennessee, is set to be replaced at ever-increasing cost estimates. A giant factory there called the Uranium Processing Facility could produce weapons-grade uranium for new H-bombs if it can ever be designed. The original $1.5 billion cost estimate has now ballooned to $6.5 billion. The local citizens watchdog group there reports that the $6.5 billion estimate has been pulled from thin air. It's made of fairy dust. It's not derived from a design. It doesn't calculate materials and labor. It's a blank check for the military contractors who are involved with designing and potentially building it. The worst part of this Tennessee boondoggle, there's the word again, is that the National Nuclear Security Agency, which oversees the nuclear weapons complex, is directing a project here that says the design is for production 8 times greater than what's necessary. Well, this $1 trillion weapons rebuild program also includes plans to replace 180 or so B-61 gravity bombs that you may have heard of, now deployed by the United States Air Force in 5 European NATO partners, Germany, Holland, Italy, Belgium, and Turkey. European public opinion overwhelmingly agrees that these Cold War relics should be permanently withdrawn, and dozens of nonviolent resistors are risking arrest at the Bushehr Air Force Base this week, even today, in Germany, demanding that the 20 B-61s still deployed at the Bushehr Base be removed from there for good. People at Bushehr have had a 16-year-long campaign going to get rid of the last vestige of the Cold War B-61s there. If you don't think keeping U.S. nuclear bombs in far-flung and even unstable NATO states is something like a death wish and a foolhardy temptation to suicidal terrorists, remember this. The failed military coup, July 15th in Turkey, was headquartered at the Incirlik Air Force Base, home to 90 of these U.S. B-61s. Thermonuclear gravity bombs, each with 33 times the force of the Hiroshima bomb. All the top commanders at the Incirlik base have been arrested. as a result of the failed coup, leaving deputy officers in charge of the 90 so-called nuclear sharing bombs. That's what the program's called in Europe, nuclear sharing. Now, these devices that could someday bring new meaning to the term suicide attack. There have been 20 such attacks in Turkey since 9/11. But the weapons engineers in this country and their funders in the US Congress on one hand, and NATO forces sharing these US H-bombs in Europe on the other hand, share a grim and terrible partnership. They enjoy the prestige, the high salaries, top security clearances, the annual promotions, and the elite priestly status of being associated with hydrogen bombs. The apex and the zenith of actual terrorism the world over, and the taproot of violence in this country that paves the way for any and all lesser mass destruction from fuel air explosives or thermobaric bombs or depleted uranium cluster munitions, napalm and phosphorus bombs. The potential use of these nuclear weapons makes these lesser bombs appear acceptable and benign even to the general public, because the military didn't go nuclear. They were so moderate. Our nuclear war planners desperately need sarcasm and trivialization to justify their association with these unspeakable weapons. I have a t-shirt that makes light of the permanent cancer-causing radioactive legacy of nuclear weapons. This is a souvenir from the Los Alamos National Laboratory that you can get at the gift shop in New Mexico.
Wow.
A souvenir that visitors can pick up for a couple of dollars from the shop, where tourists can make fun of the laboratory's principal contribution to science, the incineration of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Los Alamos is where they tested the bomb, developed it first. When I got one federal bomb designer on the telephone for an interview, this was 10 years ago, I asked why Lawrence Livermore National Lab in California wasn't being used to invent and develop not new weapons, but a container that might hold the radioactive waste from the nuclear arms race that has to be isolated from the water for 25,000 years. He said, this is a direct quote, "We like to cook. We don't like to do the dishes." We mustn't be captured or seduced by this denial and the cynicism that shifts responsibility and treats plans for mass destruction as if it were like making dinner. Our nuclear weapons are not just bigger bombs, as so many North Americans want to believe. Even the smallest nuclear weapons we have blind people 50 miles away from ground zero. Remember that the atomic bombings were and always will be gobsmacking in their power. Killing 140,000 people at Hiroshima, 70,000 in Nagasaki. These bombs incinerated with a single device what had taken 464 B-29 bombers. You remember Major General Curtis LeMay and his incendiary bombing of Japanese cities. The firebombing of Tokyo took 464 B-29s. They killed 100,000 people on March 9th. But these new devices did that with a single blow. Has somebody got a clock watch on me?
There's another couple
of minutes.
Okay. Well, excuse me for repeating something that's in my column in this week's Reader, but I'd like to go after Sarah Palin for a second. She smugly criticized Barack Obama's May 27th visit to Hiroshima. Palin said that Obama had insulted veterans by going there and laying a wreath at the memorial. On the contrary, the manufactured fiction that the atomic bombings were justifiable retribution for Japanese aggression and were done to prevent U.S. military casualties, that is the worst insult of World War II Pacific combat veterans and a gross, I should say, gross trivialization of their sacrifices. Death-defying U.S. bomber units and combat troops that fought so mightily in bloody, drawn-out battles for Midway and Guadalcanal and Iwo Jima and Okinawa and elsewhere. These are the people who actually won the war against Japan, as dozens of high-level military officials have testified. Curtis LeMay himself, who directed the air war and destroyed 67 Japanese cities, said for the record at a press conference September 20th, 1945, in New York City, he said the war would have been over in 2 weeks without the Russians entering and without the atomic bomb. He was pressed by a reporter who asked, had they not surrendered because of the atomic bomb? And General LeMay said the atomic bomb had nothing to do with the end of the war at all. General LeMay calculated that the Japanese would surrender by September 1st after his mass firebombing effort would have destroyed what he said, quote unquote, was everything in Japan. Admiral Lewis Strauss wrote in 1960, he's a naval historian, he said, for authoritative statements as to the condition of Japan in the late spring of 1945, at least from the Navy's point of view, there are statements by Admiral King, Admiral Halsey, Admiral Radford, Admiral Nimitz, and others who said that neither the atomic bomb nor the proposed invasion of Japan, Japanese mainland, were necessary to produce the surrender. Admiral William Leahy, who was Truman's chief of staff, was adamant. He said, quote, it's my opinion that the use of this barbarous weapon at Hiroshima and Nagasaki was of no material assistance in our war against Japan, end quote. In the scholarly circles of book readers and historians, it's common knowledge and it's a general consensus that, as Samuel Walker, a former chief historian for the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, said in 1990, the consensus among scholars is that the bomb was not needed to avoid an invasion of Japan and to end the war. It's clear that alternatives to the bomb existed and that Truman and his advisors knew it. So no, the insult is that H-bombs can be considered useful. The insult is the idea that some sort of positive good can come from the commission of massacres. It's the mass rejection of this hateful thinking that has created a groundswell nowadays among governments and civil society groups who have declared that humanitarian law supersedes the military doctrines of the 9 nuclear armed states. This is why 127 nations have signed the humanitarian pledge that commits them to efforts to stigmatize, prohibit, and eliminate nuclear weapons with an explicit treaty ban, something the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons, ICAN, is working so hard to accomplish with chapters in major cities all over the world. The 127 signers of this pledge understand that nuclear weapons cannot be used with military practicality, ethical justification, or lawful authority. Well, we do have our work cut out for us in the United States. Even as the total number of H-bombs has actually shrunk in the U.S. arsenal over the last 20 years, the weapons budget has increased. It's doubled in the past 16 years, from 2000, when the government spent $4.3 billion on nuclear weapons, to this year, 2016, in which $8.84 billion was spent on a smaller nuclear arsenal. Representative Adam Smith, the Democrat of Washington, the ranking member of the House Armed Services Committee, was joined by several people in the House and dared to critique this nuclear weapon spending. 159 House members joined him in pushing an amendment which would have slashed funding for the nuclear cruise missile I mentioned early on. Of course, Lockheed Martin and Boeing Corporation weighed in heavily to oppose the amendment, and it was defeated along party lines. Lockheed Martin, with offices right in St. Paul, Minnesota, spent $14 million on lobbying in 2013 and has spent $188 million just since 1998. Now, this is the corruption that we're up against. Federal tax money that goes to Lockheed to build the weapons is then used to lobby Congress to keep the weapons money coming. This is spiritual death that Dr. King warned of decades ago. And this death is illustrated every day in the scandalous rates of suicide, drug addiction, and overdoses, and the multiple mass shootings by deranged gunmen in our sorry state. So please do something to withdraw your support for this self-destructive cycle. Stop paying war taxes. Stop supporting these war contractors and subcontractors. Throw a wrench into the gears of this endless war profiteering. And say a prayer for the survivors of all this violence. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John, for sharing that information with us. Clearly, it's time past due for some new ways of thinking, for some creativity, for some imagination of a new world. And to lead us into that today with a bit of song is Ian Cannell, who's going to sing for us, and we can join in, I'm sure, as you like, with John Lennon's Imagine.
Yeah, I've found these peace songs tend to work a little better when everybody's singing. So if you know the words, please, please feel free to sing along.
No heaven.
Thank you, Ian. I'd like now to introduce Donna Howard. Donna has been a lifelong activist and staunchly anti-nuclear, and was active in the campaign to try to close down the ELF long-range communication system to nuclear submarines in Wisconsin, and as a result of her protests, spent a total of over a year incarcerated. So we'll hear now from Donna Howard.
Thank you, Donna.
I want to thank Vets for Peace for giving us a chance to grieve and express our sorrow and our regret. And I want to thank John LaForge for giving us the information, for giving us the ugly reality of the world that we live in now. I knew that John would cover the facts really well, and that gives me leeway to speak as a woman, to speak from the right brain, to speak from the heart. Can you live in the reality that John just described? Can we live in that reality? Can the seventh generation have its turn on this precious planet and live in that reality? Can the very next generation live with that reality? The US and Russia currently have a total of 900 missiles and 2,581 strategic nuclear warheads on high alert, launch ready status. How long can we live with that? If you believe in God, do you think this is what God wants for us? If you believe that life on Earth is sacred and worthy of protection, do you believe that we can overlook the reality of these weapons and carry on with business as usual? What can we do? I think ringing this bell is essential. I think it's required of us. Our spirits need to ring this bell. We need to look back in history and bear the pain of knowing that we dropped the worst weapon of mass destruction ever used onto our brothers and sisters in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. We need to turn that pain into determination that it will never happen again.
Yes. Amen.
That grief is real. Those of us who actually have looked at this feel that pain really deeply. When I was in prison for disarming the Navy nuclear weapons at ELF, two reporters from the largest newspaper in Japan came to my cell to interview me, and they asked me some questions about what I had done and what it was like, etc. But then they asked me, is there anything you want to say to the people of Japan? And I just burst into sobs. And there was nothing I could do but sob and say, tell them we're trying. Tell them we want them to be safe. I mean, what do we say to the people of Japan? We need to ring the bell. But ringing the bell isn't enough. I put the question, what can we do to you, to all of us? Because I don't know the answer. The Plowshares movement is still alive and well. I thank Greg Birchie for his last action. And there are no doubt others who can take a period of their lives to use household tools in addressing the most heinous weapons that we own. The possibility of a mass movement or a gigantic march is minimal. We're all distracted by other issues and by trying to meet the needs of our brothers and sisters and of the planet. Those of us who have marched and organized and written letters and stood on street corners find ourselves tired or distracted or without leadership or without new ideas. Mostly, we're doing other things, important things. But while we're doing those other things, the weapons of mass destruction are ready to fire. They threaten all life on Earth. I'm not saying we're guilty of living with wrong priorities. I'm simply saying, what can we do? Are there young people with social network skill who could organize us to melt down the phones of the government and the Pentagon? Maybe so. It's a good time for us to do something. because the intention of building a whole new generation of nuclear weapons is getting them into the news. It's a good time to talk about that $1 trillion and what it ought to be used for. It's a good time to say that smaller, more strategic weapons are not more acceptable. It's a good time to say that we should not be starting a new arms race with Russia and China.
Yes.
So, about that $1 trillion, I'm a Catholic worker, so I think about just use of money a lot. I want housing. I want health care. I looked up some equivalents, like how many houses can you build with $1 trillion? They were ridiculous, and I don't think quantifying it in that way really helps us, because we know that if that $1 trillion were not being spent on nuclear weapons over these next decades, we'd be able to house those who need it. We'd be able to make healthcare affordable and available to everyone. We'd be able to make our schools vibrant and stimulating places. We could make college education free. You name it, it's all possible if we decommission the weapons rather than building new ones. $1 trillion is a lot of money. Obama promised at the beginning of his presidency to, quote, seek the peace and security of a world without nuclear weapons, end quote. He promised to build no new nuclear weapons. So they're combining parts from the old nuclear weapons and claiming that they aren't building anything new. We should call him and ask everyone we know to call him. He could do the right thing before the end of his presidency, but he is not. When Obama visited Hiroshima last month, the Japanese member organization of International Lawyers Against Nuclear Arms made this request of him: to be the first head of state to make a declaration, quote, that each state undertakes never under any circumstances to use or threaten to use nuclear weapons. Let's call him and ask him this. Let's ask him to promise never under any circumstances to use or threaten to use nuclear weapons. And let's say, while you're at it, get rid of the ones we have. Our children and the children of the seventh generation are relying on us to do this.
Thank you, Donna. 71 years ago this week, August 6th and August 9th, 1945, the cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki were decimated by two nuclear bombs. 250,000 civilians, women, children, young men, elderly grandparents, were killed. Grandmothers for Peace and Veterans for Peace believe it is not enough to just remember the tragic and many believe unnecessary loss of civilian lives from these events. We must work to abolish nuclear weapons forever. We now have seven people who are going to do brief readings, and then we will have a ringing seven times of the bell for each decade since those bombs were dropped, and then a closing challenge to all of us. We begin with Warren Howe.
The purpose of remembering the past is to understand the present, learn from our mistakes, and do better in the future. Knowing the awful destructiveness of nuclear weapons, why do we not see the folly of these monsters? Not perhaps, we should take responsibility for them by actively working for their abolition. We could have done that in 1945, when we were the only nation to work to have those weapons. Instead, we fueled the arms race during the Cold War, multiplying these horrific weapons, and today we are busy reigniting a new arms race in nuclear weapons. Bernard Lowe, a founding member of the International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War, has said, and I quote, "As long as we rationalize nuclear weapons as necessary in order to save American lives, then nuclear weapons will never be gotten rid of."
We'll hear now from Heather.
Hi, my name is Heather. I'll just give 1 minute about myself before I read the script. I actually wasn't intending to be a speaker today. I was asked, and you know, the reason I came here is I heard about it from the Grandmothers for Peace email list. I'm not a grandmother, but I am for peace. So, you know, I am happy to be here. And this is an issue that's fascinated me for a long time. You know, when I was in the eighth grade, I gave a presentation or talk about Hiroshima that went to state for future leaders of America, and I took a very bad position. I said that, well, we needed to do this to end World War II or to save American lives, and that's just the grand narrative that you learn in school. And I'm very thankful that I've had professors and, you know, an educational experience that has helped me to see the world differently and more peacefully and more justly. Or professors and educators have been able to imagine a different world, and that's why I'm here today. So with that said, I'll go with what's on the script. Okay. On this 71st anniversary, we can imagine, or can we imagine, a nuclear weapons-free world? After all, we created these weapons of mass destruction and are the only nation to ever use them against civilian targets. It is time for us to take responsibility for them by actively working for their abolition. General Omar Bradley said in 1948, "The way to win an atomic war is to make certain it never starts. And the way to make sure it never starts is to abolish the dangerous, costly nuclear stockpiles which imprison mankind." But the leadership of our country is still mired in the old Cold War mentality. They still believe nuclear weapons are necessary for national defense. They continue to pour money into their development. They have not learned from the mistakes of our 71 years of excessively militarized foreign policy. The Cold War is over, but the danger from nuclear weapons remain. Nuclear weapons do not make us more secure. They threaten all life on Earth.
Next is Air Force veteran Mark Johnson.
Unfortunately, we are still imagining that we need nuclear weapons. We imagine that they are necessary to our national defense and safety. For decades, the nuclear weapons industry, a giant whirlpool sucking our tax dollars, has purported to keep us free and safe. It is very expensive. Between 1946 and 1996, we spent an estimated $8.66 trillion on them. But is it necessary? Not according to Lieutenant General Robert Gard, Jr., U.S. Army retired. He works for the Center for Arms Control and Non-Proliferation and is quoted on the U.S. Labor Against War website. Here's his quote. "Perhaps the most egregiously wasteful defense expenditure is the excessive budget for the entire nuclear weapons complex, estimated to cost $640 billion over the next decade. This includes expenditures for unnecessary infrastructure, nuclear warhead modernization, and new and expensive delivery systems at a time that we are reducing the role of nuclear weapons in our defense strategy." End of quote. The huge expense of our militarized foreign policy creates budget deficits and cripples efforts to create real homeland security. Real security is a living wage job, access to health care, and a secure retirement. Real security is decent, affordable housing. Real security is providing debt-free education. Real security is a foreign policy that makes friends rather than enemies. Real security addresses the root causes of terrorism rather than increasing terrorist recruits with drones bombing innocent people.
Thank you, Mark. Next is Dr. Gary Coles.
The costly spending on nuclear weapons continues. The Obama administration is moving forward with a nuclear modernization program that will ultimately cost over $1 trillion. The U.S. Air Force has just taken a first step toward buying controversial new nuclear weapons in late July, asking defense companies to submit bids to design and build cruise missiles and ICBMs. This, despite the fact that President Obama himself has warned that ramping up new and more deadly and more effective systems will likely end up leading to a whole new escalation of the nuclear arms race. Now is the time to join in support of those U.S. senators who have called on the Obama administration to cancel plans to build a new cruise missile, a long-range standoff weapon.
Thank you, Gary. Next is Bob Tamman.
Thank you, John. As a member of Veterans for Peace, who served on the ground in Vietnam and was part of the war machine that killed so many Vietnamese soldiers and civilians, these words are especially meaningful to me today. Nuclear weapons are a real threat to the safety and well-being of everyone. Given the power of nuclear weapons, the environmental damage caused by their production, and the record of accidents involving them, this is not just hypothetical rhetoric. If we cannot imagine the abolition of these horrific weapons, we may not have a future. General Colin Powell has said, "Today I can declare my hope that we will eventually see the time when that number of nuclear weapons is down to zero and the world is a much better place."
So we gather today to remember and mourn the tragedies of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, but we also remember to say, never again in our name. We remember to say in the words of Isaiah, "They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore."
We must work to abolish nuclear weapons. We know the politicians will not act. It is up to us as citizens to remember the past and take action to build a better, safer, nuclear weapons-free future. Is this unrealistic? Is it utopian? Not according to General George Lee Butler, head of U.S. Strategic Nuclear Forces from 1991 to 1994, who has said, "It is a measure of arrogance to assert that a nuclear weapons-free world is impossible when 95% of the nations of the world are already nuclear-free. There is no security in nuclear weapons. It's a fool's game." Even President Ronald Reagan has advocated their abolition. He said in 1984, "A nuclear war cannot be won and must never be fought. Would it not be better to do away with them entirely?" We need a new 21st century foreign policy. We need new thinking that projects cooperation and peaceful problem solving rather than military power. We need foreign policy that advances the needs of people based on democratic ideals that once inspired the world. In memory of the victims of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the first two tragedies of the nuclear age, in memory of the many people who have advocated for abolishing nuclear weapons over the last 71 years, and to dedicate ourselves to continue the work for a nuclear-free world, we ring this peace bell. We ring the bell once for each of the 7 decades that the world has lived in fear of the nuclear holocaust.
That we can be doing, and we've passed out here today a flyer from with information about a online petition from Roots Action. You can go online, Google Roots Action, or you can poke in the address there on that, and you can sign asking the United States and the other nuclear powers of the world to support the United Nations Convention on Nuclear Weapons. 127 other countries are supporting this. We do not. Also, John LaForge has a petition here on asking our political leaders to abolish the ICBMs, the land-based ICBM, intercontinental ballistic missiles, that are still on alert in our country. And you can come up and sign that as well. And I would encourage you to, as Donna said, call, write, email, and bug your elected officials and President Obama until they stop this madness of, you know, continuing to build and improve nuclear weapons.
If you find yourself thinking, if only there were something I could do, I want you to pay very close attention to the last verse of this song. It's "If I Had a Hammer." Sing along if you know the words. If I had a hammer, I'd hammer in the morning. I'd hammer in the evening, all over this land. I'd hammer out danger. I have a hammer, and I have
Amen, friends. Let's go in peace and work for justice and imagine a new world.
No, I'm wrong.